there is a great danger presented by Chris White and most professing Protestants' misinterpretation of the verse regarding the seven mountains or hills in the Book of the Revelation. They clearly do not realise where their views originated from and why they were conceived. This verse clearly, as I shall show, reveals the papacy as the very Antichrist. Now, if you disagree, don't dismiss me immediately. Please hear my side of the argument before concluding. He that answereth the matter before he heareth it, it is folly and shame unto him. Before we discuss the verse in question, I'm reminded of John the Baptist when he was imprisoned and began to doubt that Jesus was the actual prophesied Messiah, even after hearing God's voice from heaven declaring that Jesus was his beloved son. Luke 7:19, and John, calling unto him two of his disciples, sent them to Jesus, saying, Art thou he that should come, or look we for another? The Lord Jesus returns a simple message of all the prophecies he has fulfilled. He was quite clearly the Christ, the Son of God. So let us pose the same question to the Pope as the Antichrist. Is he the Antichrist, or do we look for another? Well, firstly, Roman Catholicism is the only movement in Christian history to have so spanned across the world, sitting upon many waters, as it were, holding sway over many nations, thus being the largest misrepresentation of biblical Christianity that has ever existed, by far. For many centuries, it dominated Christendom, presenting itself as the only true church, and persecuting all others mercilessly. It is that whore which is a counterfeit of the true bride of Christ. Its official colours of the priesthood are scarlet and purple. Roman Catholicism also is the wealthiest organisation in the world, as is declared in the prophecies of the whore and her influence over kings and merchants of the earth. Papal Rome is nothing but a continuation of pagan Rome, with the title of Pontifex Maximus, its trinkets, rituals and symbolism being identical to that of the Babylonian mystery religion of old. No other religion has done this so blatantly, on such a vast scale, and in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, as to deserve the title Mystery Babylon the Great, apart from Romanism. She is the seat of idolatry under the New Testament, just as Babylon was in the Old. There are the titles the Pope claims. Vicar of Christ literally means Antichrist, in the place of Christ. He claims to be the overseer of the Christian religion, its supreme bishop and high priest, Melchizedek in order, and the physician of souls. He claims to be the Holy Father, the head of the churches, and most divine of all heads, and the rock against which the proud gates of hell prevail not. Truly, the Pope exalts himself above all that is called God. And indeed, upon her forehead was written the name Mystery. The word for mystery here was actually written on the front of the Pope's mitre until more reformers took notice. This is because the Church of Rome aims to initiate souls into the mystery of Christ, dubbing itself the Mystagogue. And these are not blasphemous titles thrust upon the papacy by others. The title Lord God the Pope appears in the edition of the Canon Law, published by Gregory XIII. Pope Pius V said this, "The Pope and God are the same, so he has all power in heaven and earth." Pope Leo XIII said this about the role of the Pope, "We hold upon this earth the place of God Almighty." History shows that the papacy has exercised the greatest control over the governments of the earth since the ascent of the Lord Jesus into heaven, and it still continues to do so. No other organisation has persecuted the children of God as much as the Roman Catholic religion. The conservative estimates of the deaths of Bible-believing Christians who would not partake of Rome's blasphemies is staggering, dwarfing the Holocaust. Again, this is exactly what we are forewarned to expect of the great whore of the Revelation. I could go on, as the testimony is clear according to the prophecies of the Revelation. But what about other prophecies from Scripture of the Antichrist and his final world empire? Daniel prophesies of kingdoms that would follow on from Nebuchadnezzar's Babylon until the kingdom of Christ. There would be the Meso-Persian Empire, then the Greek Empire, and then the Roman Empire, which I'm sure many of you will know was the iron legs of the statue, which then divided into 10 toes in Daniel's vision. These toes were part of iron and part of clay, and these don't mingle with each other. Daniel also prophesies of the little horn who would rise up to rule over those 10 toes in another part of the prophecy. Note that this is the final empire to be in existence at the coming of Christ, as we take another look at the verses in question. Revelation chapter 17 verses 9 to 10. And here is the mind which hath wisdom. The 7 heads are 7 mountains on which the woman sitteth. And there are 7 kings. 5 are fallen, and 1 is. And the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. Now firstly, there are 7 kings. 5 have fallen, and 1 is currently in existence. Who was the king that had power over the kings of the earth at the time when John wrote the Revelation? Well, let's look in the scriptures. Luke chapter 2 verse 1, and it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And we don't see anywhere in the Bible or history to indicate that the Caesars ceased to exist before John wrote the Revelation. So we can say that the 6th head of the beast, or 6th king of this empire, is the Caesar of the Roman Empire. Furthermore, there had been 5 previous forms of government of the Roman Empire, which are the 5 fallen heads of the beast in verse 10. But the 7th head to follow was not yet come at the time that John wrote the Revelation. In 2 Thessalonians, Paul says that before that wicked, speaking of the Antichrist, is revealed, there will be a falling away and something else must occur. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 verses 7 to 8. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work, only he who now letteth will let, until he be taken out of the way, and then shall that wicked be revealed. According to the early church, he who now letteth was safe language for Paul to use to indicate the Caesar of Rome, considering his precarious circumstances. Justin Martyr and Irenaeus wrote in this vein. Also, just listen to Tertullian's commentary on 2 Thessalonians 2, verses 7 to 8. What obstacle is there but the Roman state? The falling away of which, by being scattered into 10 kingdoms, shall introduce Antichrist upon its own ruins. And just listen to what the papists have to say about this historic event. It is therefore by a particular decree of divine providence that at the fall of the Roman Empire and its partition into separate kingdoms, the Roman pontiff, whom Christ made the head and centre of his entire church, acquired civil power. Comparing scripture with scripture, we see that the Antichrist will follow on from the Caesar of Rome and will be that great misrepresentation of the body of Christ that has been outlined previously and which has been entirely fulfilled in papal Rome. When the pagan Roman Empire fell, Europe was divided into 10 kingdoms, those 10 toes of Daniel's vision, but the deadly head wound of the beast was healed. Pagan Rome revived as papal Rome, with all of the hallmarks of its Babylonish mystery religion. The Pope declared himself to be Pontifex Maximus, the same title as the Emperor of Rome. He then absorbed 3 of those 10 European kingdoms, just as Daniel prophesied, and the other supposedly Christianized kings of Europe submitted to the authority of the Pope. Since that time, that Pope has attempted to unify Europe as the new Roman Empire, the Holy Roman Empire, the Second and Third Reichs. But these attempts have been to no avail. The 10 toes, the iron and clay, do not mix, just as Daniel prophesied. History itself wonderfully testifies of the authenticity of this Antichrist. Therefore, I find the idea presented by Chris White that a Christian need not know history to understand the Revelation, particularly these verses, absurd. especially as Chris White in other of his videos states that we can look at history and discover the validity of the things written in the New Testament, the validity of Christ's very existence and his resurrection, or the validity of Christ's prophecies such as the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. Why then is it unfaithful to look at history to see the fulfillment of things written in this book of prophecy, the Revelation? Doesn't John say that one of the kings is, i.e. is reigning in his time? What of the king who was to come after the Caesars? We can ascertain from scripture that the one to come after Caesar is the Antichrist. But which rule took over from pagan Roman Caesar? Does scripture tell us explicitly? No. These things had not come to pass when John wrote, but when they did, the Christians of the early church understood full well what was going to come to pass, as we have seen. Well then, should we not desire to see if a worldwide system on the scale and in the vein of the Antichrist did emerge after pagan Rome fell? Should we not study the matter? After all, we're told that this matter requires wisdom at the start of the verses in question. Are we to simply throw away the past 2,000 years of history, as Chris White suggests? Have the martyrs died in vain and their testimonies against the chief persecutor of the body of Christ been for naught? No, I certainly will not go along with the interpretation presented by most professing Protestants today, which is the futurist version of the Revelation, which speaks of a 7-year tribulation period at the very end of time, in which the Antichrist makes a peace treaty with Israel, way off in the future, etc., etc. This view was developed and promulgated by two Jesuit priests, Francisco Ribera and Manuel Lacunza. Their chief aim was to infect Protestantism with a different view of the Revelation and primarily to stop people identifying the Pope of Rome as that man of sin, which was the main Protestant doctrine until very recently. Does this sound like a good tree from which this fruit has come? Indeed, it is nothing but poison in the well. But let's continue and come to the very crux of Chris White's argument as we draw to a conclusion. Revelation chapter 17, verses 9 to 10. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sitteth, and there are seven kings. Verse 10 apparently should be translated, and they are seven kings. Meaning we can just forget about the wording of seven hills or seven mountains altogether. It's just another bit of symbolism that Almighty God just chose to throw into the mix and probably has no real purpose at all. Seven heads, seven mountains, it's just talking about seven kings. The translators of the Authorized Version just made a bit of a boo-boo, according to Chris White. This is a tall claim from someone who admits that they are far from being a Greek scholar. The learned Baptist commentator, Dr. John Gill, however, agrees with Chris White regarding this translation, and yet he does not arrive at the same conclusion at all. In his commentary, he writes, "The Arabic version renders it, 'Who are seven kings?' And it should be rendered, as it is by the Vulgate Latin, the Syriac and Ethiopic versions, 'and they are seven kings.' That is, the seven heads signify seven kings also, for they have in them a double representation, first of seven mountains, and then of seven kings. By the seven heads are meant so many forms of government which took place successively in the Roman Empire, and were all of them idolatrous heads, as kings, consuls, dictators, decemvirs, tribunes, emperors, and popes." Though I do not agree with the hugely intelligent Dr. Gill on a number of doctrines, his is a classic example of Greek scholarship which does not throw the seven mountains of Revelation 17:9 out of the window, along with the past 2,000 years of Christian history. Indeed, many mainstream translations today use the translation, "They are also seven kings," favoured by the great scholar and father of the English Bible, William Tyndale. The ISV, NIV and ESV all render it this way. And of course, this is a preferable translation, as it does not invalidate the text of Seven Mountains. But the translation used in the Authorized Version, "and there are seven kings," is even better, as it brings all of the symbolism of these verses together. The woman is a city, according to the context of verse 18, and she is sitting on these mountains, and there, in that place, are seven kings, these two elements culminating in the symbolism of the seven heads. Furthermore, this translation is not a one-off mistake by the Authorized Version translators, as Chris White suggests. Young's literal translation uses it, as does Webster's Bible, the Aramaic Bible in plain English, and even John Nelson Darby's translation. Ironically, the man responsible for pushing the futurist interpretation of the Revelation on Protestantism after reading the writings of the aforementioned Jesuits. The reality is, the Greek here may be translated either way, they or there. However, as it literally means, "and the kings, they are seven," the more idiomatic translation would be, "and there are seven kings." There is the possibility of interpreting them as additional, but no necessity to do so. But the centre of my argument is that the seven mountains are integral to the identification of this woman, this city, and must not be ignored. Revelation 17:18, "And the woman which thou sawest is that great city which reigneth over the kings of the earth." Let me ask you a question. How can a city sit on seven kings? Indeed, it is none other than that city which reigned over the kings of the earth in John's day, Rome. And this great city does indeed sit on seven hills. And not only this, but it has been declared throughout history as that great city which sits on seven hills. Propertius speaks of it as the lofty city on seven hills, which governs the whole world. The Catholic Encyclopedia itself states, "It is within the city of Rome, called the city of seven hills, that the entire area of Vatican State proper is now confined." What is the alternative here? That great city which sits on seven hills and reigns over the kings of the earth. Yes, that's right. Sheffield. In conclusion, I will not hold to an interpretation of the Revelation developed by the wicked Jesuits, and I will not ignore the worldwide system of Antichrist that has so clearly been fulfilled in the papacy. The Pontifex Maximus rose and has continued, fulfilling prophecy, in fact, the prophecy that he would continue 1260 days was fulfilled perfectly when exactly 1260 years passed and that same pope had his temporal power taken from him. And although the papacy has nowhere near the power it exerted over mankind in previous centuries, being very much weakened in the past 140 years, this false prophet is still an enemy, full of all subtlety and mischief, which does not cease to pervert the right ways of the Lord. This is a widely underestimated and unseen enemy, to the detriment of many Protestants, so-called. To close, I would like to read Dr. Gill's commentary on verse 9 of Revelation 17. "The seven heads are seven mountains, on which the woman sitteth." As the woman is a city, from verse 18, these seven mountains on which she sits must be so many mountains on which the city is built. And what city can this be but Rome, which is so famous for being built on seven hills? This is taken notice of by Virgil, Horace, Ovid, Claudian, Starius, Martial, and others. And indeed, there is scarce a poet that speaks of Rome but observes it. Hence, it has been sometimes called by writers the seven-hilled city, and sometimes septiceps, meaning seven-headed city, which comes near to the language here. And in this situation it was, in John's time, for Pliny, who was contemporary with him, expressly says that in his time it took in seven mountains, and that this refers to a city in John's time, then reigning over the kings of the earth, is certain from verse 18. Now, there was no imperial city so built in his time but Rome. For though Constantinople is built on seven hills, yet this was not in being in John's time, but was built by Constantine many years after, in imitation of Rome. And though the situation is much altered now, being in Campus Martius, it being greatly reduced, and in a less compass, yet this hinders not but that it is the same city here designed. And this confirms that the beast before spoken of, on whom the woman sat, is the Roman Empire, since she is here said to sit on the seven mountains on which Rome, the metropolis of that empire, was built. And this shows the Pope of Rome to be Antichrist, the great whore, Babylon, the mother of harlots, since no other has his seat at Rome but he. I thank you for listening, and I do ask that you would prayerfully consider these things.